Boardwalk Empire is a HBO period crime drama created by Terence Winter and starring Steve Buscemi, set in 1920s Prohibition-era Atlantic City. The show follows many real-life historical crime figures, such as Al Capone, Charlie Luciano, Meyer Lansky, and Joe Masseria, and is based on real-life events. It also has many fictional characters, such as Nucky Thompson, loosely based on political figure Enoch Lewis Nucky Johnson, and Jimmy Darmody, Nucky's protégé. Now, the proper title of this video is Why Did They Kill Off Jimmy Darmody So Early? But since that's a huge spoiler, I chose not to mention the name of the character in the title. On one hand, it's been years since Boardwalk Empire finished, so you'd hope you can talk about it openly. On the other hand, the show is not as popular and well-known as, say, The Sopranos, The Godfather, Goodfellas, etc. And I'm sure there's a chance many of my subscribers haven't seen this show, so I didn't include Darmody's name in the video title. This is my first analysis video of Boardwalk Empire, but I have actually reviewed seasons 2, 3, 4, and 5 on the channel, so check them out if you'd like. And if you like what you see on the channel, please consider subscribing and hitting the notification bell so you don't miss out on future videos. Jimmy Darmody, played by Michael Pitt, is the son of political giant Commodore Keistner and showgirl Gillian Darmody. At the time of his birth, his father was 54 and his mother only 13. It was Nucky Thompson who made the arrangement, at the request of the Commodore, to deliver Gillian to the Commodore so he could have relations with her. A World War I veteran, Jimmy returns to Atlantic City in 1920 in season 1 and shows clear signs of post-traumatic stress disorder from his experiences in the war. Jimmy eventually goes to work for Nucky as his driver and bodyguard, and the two share a close relationship. Some might say Nucky was a second father to Jimmy, and Jimmy has deep-rooted resentment for his own father, the Commodore. However, he reconciles with his dad and becomes deeply hurt and enraged when he discovers it was Nucky who arranged for the rape of his mother at the hands of the Commodore. This leads Jimmy to align himself with his father to betray Nucky and take back control of Atlantic City from him. Aside from Nucky, who is the clear protagonist of the series, Jimmy is the closest thing to a main character the show gives us. We spend a lot of time with him and learn of his troubles and issues, both externally and internally, and season 2 only expands on this, with him sinking deeper into alcohol and heroin addiction after numerous stress-inducing events, including the murder of his wife. He agrees to put out a hit on Nucky after being pressured by his mob allies, which fails. He attacks his mother after she makes passing comments about his deceased wife, and in the ensuing scuffle he ends up killing his own father. Before this, Jimmy had taken over his father's operations after the Commodore suffered a stroke, meaning he was forced to navigate his way through the murky Atlantic City underworld without the cunning and wisdom of his father. Jimmy makes himself enemies in all directions, and flashbacks highlight to us a disturbing past, where he even had a drunken sexual encounter with his own mother. He tries to make amends with Nucky, and the two work together temporarily, and Nucky calls his protégé to tell him he has kidnapped an enemy of Jimmy's so he can come and kill him. However, Jimmy is aware that he is being lured into a trap, but willingly goes to his own doom. During an ominous meeting with Nucky, Jimmy tells his former mentor that he truly died during the war, and then shockingly, Nucky shoots Jimmy dead. It's an astonishing end to season 2, and many fans expected Jimmy to carry the show and be our anchor. He was a complex character, deep, troubled, interesting, and sympathetic, but season 2 stunned fans by bringing his story to a bloody end. So why did the showrunners choose to kill Jimmy so early in the life of Boardwalk Empire? Why didn't they continue his story deep into the series? Well, interestingly, Boardwalk Empire creator Terence Winter said that he always planned to kill Jimmy off in the series, but did not think it would happen so soon. The original plan was to actually have Jimmy survive season 2, but the storyline was forced to change when Dabney Coleman, the actor who portrayed the Commodore, began receiving treatment for cancer during filming. In order to accommodate this, the Commodore was given a reduced role, with him having a stroke in the series and Jimmy essentially replacing him, becoming the leader of the rebellion against Nucky. The further the writers got into the process, the more they came to realize that the only logical conclusion to the story was for Nucky to kill Jimmy. The decision for Jimmy to be killed off was made at the beginning of season 2. Winter has said, "I always knew he would die at Nucky's hand. In plotting season 2, it became clear that if we were going to tell this story honestly, it was going to happen at the end of the year. He was such a huge character, and we love Michael. It was one of the hardest decisions I've ever had to make as a writer. The idea was to try and push things to their absolute limit, even if it makes it difficult for yourself and your writing team. If you take things to their logical extreme with the situation we created, Jimmy had betrayed Nucky, he tried to have him killed. You want to be honest about the storytelling. In the pilot, Jimmy told Nucky, "You can't be half a gangster anymore." We wanted with the first two seasons to follow that trajectory, where he goes full season from being the guy who doesn't want to get his hands dirty to actually pulling the trigger himself. And what's the strongest version of that? To pull the trigger on the very guy who told him, "You can't be half a gangster anymore." It's like, guess what? You're right, I can't. And here's now me fully becoming a gangster. Anything short of Nucky doing it himself wouldn't feel real. It wouldn't be real. And it would be a cheat for us to say we want to keep our beloved character Jimmy Darmody alive. Winter wanted the audience of Boardwalk Empire to be misled, to think that Nucky and Jimmy would reconcile and there would be a happy ending to the duo story. He said, "I wanted them to think right up to the very end that Nucky is going to forgive him and take him back. It was a really hard decision. You're sort of blowing up your own show in some ways. Now we're back in the writer's room trying to figure out where we go from here without Jimmy Darmody." Personally, I never really had a problem with Jimmy being killed off at the end of season 2. When I started watching Boardwalk Empire, I came to see a prohibition-era gangster drama with all the real-life bootleggers and bandits like Capone and Luciano. I didn't want the show to follow fictional characters banging their mums. Don't get me wrong, Jimmy was an interesting character, but I felt people like him were necessary in the beginning as anchors and bridges between the far more interesting real-life characters who had yet to reach their primes in the story. Once the trajectory of the storylines concerning the likes of Meyer, Lansky and Charlie Luciano got going, Jimmy wasn't really needed. In fact, if he was included during infamous real-life plot threads, that could have caused the series to face a backlash for shoehorning a fictional character into historical events. I also thought Darmody was getting outpaced by characters around him, and the fact that he constantly made mistakes and made numerous enemies meant it was clear that his story wasn't going to have a happy ending. Interestingly, there have been rumors that Jimmy was killed off because the actor who played him, Michael Pitt, was difficult to work with on set and a hothead. He was fired by his agent in 2011, and the reason cited was that he was really difficult on set and otherwise. This has been denied by Terence Winter, who has said that this rumor was absolutely not true. And he also added, "Michael is a total professional. He's intense, of course, but I don't think you can do that job without being intense." Interestingly, Terence Winter has said that it was difficult to tell Pitt that his character was going to be killed off. During the conference phone conversation where the revelation would be made, where executive producer Martin Scorsese was present, Pitt's phone connection kept on cutting out as he was upstate in New York on a fishing trip, and after several attempts, the ever-busy Scorsese had to get back to work and it became clear they couldn't tell Pitt softly that he was going to be killed off. Marty was like, "Let me just email him," Winter said. I said, "We can't email, we have to have this conversation." But we couldn't get him back on the phone, so ultimately, I felt horrible, but I had to send him an email. "I don't want you to get the script and read this, but you sort of knew where this was going." He was totally fine with it. Reportedly, Pitt requested that his character be killed off in the worst way possible. Winter recalled, "Joe Pantoliano made the same request on The Sopranos. He said, 'I love being on this show, but if you have to kill me, please take me out with a bang.' We said, 'Done.'" Pantoliano, by the way, is the guy who played Ralph Cifaretto, and if you didn't already know, Terence Winter was one of the writers on The Sopranos. In terms of Darmody willingly going to his death, Winter has said, "He's so emotionally damaged. I don't think Jimmy ever expected to come back alive from World War I. I think he probably left for the war hoping he would die and was surprised he survived. He's been a walking dead person ever since we've met him. He's come back and gone through the motions of a person trying to make his way in the world, but ultimately he becomes resigned to his fate. He gets manipulated into this run against Nucky, who was his mentor, and really the only father figure of any meaning he has. The plot failed, and he knows, as a good soldier, he's going to have to fall on his sword. He fully knows what he's walking into at the end. He's not armed. He says goodbye to his son. He basically gives Richard Harrow permission to not come with him. He knows he needs to be punished. The circumstances of his life have unraveled to the point where he's willing to accept his fate, and psychologically, Harrow is prepared to respect that as a soldier. If you'd like to see more videos on Boardwalk Empire, let me know in the comments below, subscribe to the channel, and thanks for watching.